Please be seated. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we join you this afternoon to affirm and to celebrate the creative and athletic and academic accomplishments of many who first came to CPA as children, but are now leaving CPA as men and women. Lord, we thank you for the season in which you have entrusted them to our care, and now as they move out into the world, more than ever, we entrust them into your care. Lord, you've created today's graduates in your image. You prepared them to live inside a big story, not a small one, because it's your story. And the glory and the honor and truth and beauty and grace and love at the center story, the story of your mission in Jesus to love people and places and things to life and to leave the world better than we found it. Lord, this is your story, and now it is also theirs. And so, Father, we pray that our graduates' campuses in the future and dormitories, as well as their future homes, neighborhoods, families, places of work and play and worship would be better places and more life-giving places because they are in those places as the aroma of Jesus. Where there is hurt, Lord, grant them healing hands and healing words. Where there's hatred, grant them love. Where there's darkness, grant them light. Where there is scarcity, grant them a heart to contribute and serve. Where there's confusion, grant them wisdom. Where there's beauty, grant them a sense of thankfulness and wonder. Where there is truth, grant them faith and courage to walk in it. And Lord, for those pursuing higher education, would you grant them the knowledge that they will need in their chosen fields and the wisdom also to apply that knowledge in every facet of their lives? And for those going directly into the workforce, grant a sense of what is right and good and honoring and beautiful, especially in the confusing and complex issues that they will face. And Father, for those going into military service, either soon or in the future, let them draw their courage and their strength from you. May they serve the cause of truth and justice and freedom and the welfare of all of humanity with integrity and honor. And for all of today's graduates and their families, more than anything, may their measure of success be bound up, not in making money or in having influence or making a name for themselves, but in trusting your mercies, which are new every morning, and in bringing fame and honor to your name by doing justly, loving mercy, and walking humbly with you. And Lord, wherever the next chapter takes each one of them, would you give them character that exceeds their gifts and abilities and give them humility that exceeds their influence? Give them frequent reminders that you have not called them to be perfectly successful. Instead, you've called them to be imperfectly faithful because they're secure in the love of a perfect King and a perfect Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, we pray that you would give them Jesus. And finally, may this prayer from St. Patrick also be their prayer, as well as their foremost pursuit in the days and years ahead of them. Christ be with me, Christ within me, Christ behind me, Christ before me, Christ beside me, Christ to win me, Christ to comfort and restore me, Christ beneath me, Christ above me, Christ in quiet, Christ in danger, Christ in the hearts of all who love me, Christ in mouth of friend and stranger. And it's in Christ's name we pray all these things. Amen.
Welcome to the 28th commencement of Christ Presbyterian Academy, and congratulations to the class of 2019. I'm Nate Morrow, head of school here at Christ Presbyterian Academy. On behalf of the Academy and Christ Presbyterian Church, it is a real pleasure to host you, friends and family, on this very special day. Today is a day of celebration, and today is a day of reverence. To honor men and women of this class by awarding different areas of distinction, presenting them with their diploma, and affirming that each student has met the requirements set forth by this academy. And most importantly, to gather here in the house of the Lord, to bring our students forth, and to one last time pray a blessing over them, to mark them with his truth in front of a cloud of witnesses So they go forth, bringing his light and his life wherever they go. To all 43 different universities in 18 different states and one foreign country. Now, while today is about our students and a celebration for your families, I would be remiss not to pause and recognize the people really responsible for what's going on up here today. And that is what we call our living curriculum. The educators, the teachers, the faculty, and the staff. So we'd take a second and just applaud the faculty and staff of Christ Presbyterian Academy. Now we'll go on with our program.
It is my distinct honor and privilege to introduce our first speaker for this afternoon, our salutatorian, Dan Irvin. Dan's curriculum is among the most demanding we have seen a student take at our school. He has taken the most advanced classes that we offer in English, math, science, history, and theater arts. If our school could offer a more demanding curriculum, Dan would have taken it. He was honored at our academic awards ceremony this past week with four major awards that included our science department's highest award of excellence, the Arts Distinguished Award for Technical Theater, the AP Calculus BC Award, and the Men in the Bible Award. Obviously, Dan is ridiculously smart, but let me tell you why we truly love Dan Irvin. He is equally as humble as he is smart. He never shows off or acts like he is smarter than everyone. So many smart people need you to know that they are smart. Clearly, it is part of their identity. But not Dan. He is completely humble and delightful. He is kind, caring, and respectful. His talents and ambitions do not overshadow his empathy and awareness of others. He does not take himself too seriously. He loves a witty joke. And he masters academic challenges with a childish humility that makes his teachers want to further pour into him. He is funny, but never at the expense of others, and he is truly loved by everyone. His Bible teachers say that when Dan thinks and speaks about who God is, he exudes a weightiness and a contemplation that is rare for someone of his age. It makes us excited to think of Dan impacting the world for Jesus as he goes out into the world. We look forward to the impact that he will have on the University of Tennessee this fall as he embarks on the next chapter in his story. As Dan comes forward and his parents, Todd and Jody Irvin, stand, would you please congratulate our salutatorian of the class of 2019, Mr. Daniel Brewer Irvin.
Thank you, Mrs. Legate, for that generous introduction. And thank you to Dr. Altman and the entire CPA faculty for providing the education that has propelled me to this point. Sinatra did it his way, and so will I. Hi, my name's Dan Irvin, and I'll be your salutatorian this evening. I'd like to start out by acknowledging the amount of requests I've received for shout-outs, and also the alarming amount of threats following those requests. I therefore ask for you to indulge me for a moment. First and foremost, I'd like to thank my family. Dad, Jodes, AT, and John, you guys have been anchors to my very character, and I couldn't have made it this far without your support. I'd also like to thank my cousins, Josh, Brown, Sam, Brewer, and Jomo. I had a really great time growing up with you guys. I know I'll miss it, but I'm excited to see how we continue to grow. Thank you, Mr. Bracompas and Mr. Knox, for challenging me to be a critical thinker, not only in academia, but in everyday life as well. Thank you, Mrs. JT and Mrs. Flott, for seeing what potential I might have had and giving me the opportunity to serve as a leader. Thank you, Mr. Miller, for your unwavering dedication to the growth of both my education and my character. Thank you to all my other teachers who have guided me over the years. I couldn't ask for better mentors. I want to thank all you goobers in the Shizzle Show and SYBC. Nobody can make me laugh like you guys. I want to thank Joseph, Madeline, Reed, Jess, John, Francesca, Hannah, Briley, Trav, and the rest of the lovable cast that I've spent the last 6 years of my life with at CPA. I might have missed a few people, but know that I am thankful for all of you who have shaped and molded me over the years. I wouldn't be who I am now without all of you lifting me up. This past year of high school has certainly been interesting. I was recruited by the lovingly fearsome Mrs. JT to be assistant director of CPA's Upper School Theatrical Productions without any prior knowledge of technical theater besides being able to press play on a sound effect playlist. A couple months of busy days and late nights later, and look, Ma, I'm winning an award. I'd like to think that I serve as a representation of the senior class and the hard work that all of us exude. That's who we are, hard workers. We grit our teeth and pour our all into what we are passionate about, whether that be art, athletics, or academics. This year, our collective successes on the fields, courts, stages, and classrooms prove this truth. So it came as a bit of a surprise when, in the midst of senior year's rigorous trials, my mom introduced her latest podcast discovery to me, the title of which may be familiar to some of you, Are My Kids on Track? I took that title as a slight at first. I thought I was doing pretty well for myself. But she revealed that she was concerned with my emotional responses and attachments to the world. The way I see it, I have this habit of treating life as if it were a movie or TV show. I'm just a big fan of stories. Who isn't? This infatuation of narratives gives me really attached to ideas like those classic movie moments that I want to experience and I want to see played out through others. Nothing demonstrates this more than when I wrote an extensive high school bucket list. It covered all the basics. Befriend a group of lovable misfits, sneak around school during detention, ditch class and spend a day around Nashville. I completed less than a third of the list, and while I never did take my Ferris Bueller's Day Off, I never had to. I realize now that my attempt to force those moments was merely an exploration of redundancy. Without completing all of the classic high school experiences in that list, I lived through high school gathering my own unique classic high school experiences. I got to bask in the camaraderie of the cross-country team's Jesse Owens escapades. I developed the ability to yell at a bunch of theater kids. I struggled through the menacing Algebra 2. I helped establish an unbreakable lunch table bond. And of course, I quoted Sam Raimi's Holy Spider-Man trilogy quite exhaustively. I never needed to recreate someone else's story because I was busy experiencing my own, whether I knew it then or not. As the sun sets on our high school years, I see that my own character development was leading me to discover that the best moments weren't those John Hughes moments. Instead, my most iconic memories are all of the Dan Irvin moments that I forged alongside all of you. Pursuing a fabrication is dangerous. It risks constraining your life to a set ideal that prohibits the exploration of unique opportunities. As to whether or not I'm on track, I'm no professional, but I'd like to believe that I am. Or rather that I might be. I'll be on my track so long as I remember not to force my movie moments, but instead focus on navigating the circumstances around me, remaining ever vigilant for that next adventure to explore. Now we gaze onward, ready to engage in the adventures the world has to offer. I ask that you, my fellow graduates, focus on staying true to the characters God has designed you to be. Explore the open doors of the world, but do so standing firm in His plan for you. The future might remain a mystery, but I'm on the edge of my seat. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It is now my distinct honor and privilege to introduce our next speaker. This young lady is a distinguished scholar with a record of academic excellence, challenging herself at every level, and taking 9 AP courses, including 5 this year, and garnering national merit commended status. While many students are competitively driven to succeed at all costs, this student seeks to lift up those around her and is often found helping her peers in the classroom prepare for tests. Her chemistry teacher says she seems to always put others above herself, making it her goal to help others grasp the material that she has. She demonstrates an incredible work ethic and resilience even when faced with adversity. And while others are driven to get the A, she's guided by an unrelenting pursuit of mastery and the love of learning and understanding, as evident by always having a book in hand. Her former English teacher describes her as passionate and caring, teeming with a readiness to dive into issues while also having the guts to go toe-to-toe with anyone. Outside of the classroom, she's been an integral part of the CPA community. As one of the editors, she helped oversee the new literary magazine. She's been found behind the scenes at numerous theater productions, and she is one of seven students who earned CPA's new Seal of Biliteracy on her diploma, a national recognition for proficiency in both English and Spanish. We look forward to what God has in store for this young lady as she heads to Samford University this fall. As she comes forward and her parents Jeremy and Molly stand, would you give a round of applause to our valedictorian of the class of 2019, Sarah Westmoreland.
Thank you, Mrs. Calhoun, for that gracious introduction. And thank you to Dr. Altman and the rest of CPA's administration and faculty for an excellent experience here. I could not have asked for a better place to have spent the last 4 years. And to each of my teachers, thank you for not only the countless hours spent pouring into my education, but also my development as a person. I couldn't have made it to this moment without y'all. But now, to dive to the heart of my speech, I would like for you to travel with me to a typical morning in the lower school. It's an hour before school, and there's already a line outside of Connie Thomas and Melissa Carpenter's Learning Service offices as kids line up to practice their reading despite various obstacles that they must overcome. They are some of the unseen heroes in our community, and I believe it is stories like these that make CPA unique. When my friend and fellow senior, Lily Thomas, shared these stories with me, it reminded me of how many people work so hard behind the scenes on things that will never get recognized on a stage like this. And so while I might be valedictorian, I wanted to focus on the fact that each and every single one of us up here deserves to graduate, and we worked really hard to be here. No matter what our 4 years in the upper school looked like, we have made it to the end. And today is a celebration of that hard work. At CPA, there is a legacy of compassion and dedication because it is the life that Jesus lived and modeled for us. He purposefully chose to love and work in situations that wouldn't bring him any glory in the eyes of the world. So over the past several weeks, I have been collecting stories of seniors who have added to that legacy through small acts of heroics over the past 4 years. Acts that give us glimpses of Jesus' love. Brown Myers immediately began to shower praise on his teammate Matthew Miller, citing his efforts to set up before soccer practice, help others with physics, and reach out to lower classmen who might have questions. The senior cheerleaders this year spent hours every week during football season creating goodie bags meant to encourage the football players before each and every one of their games. I think of the 9 boys who let me join their group during our senior trip to Universal after I got lost and couldn't find my group anymore, and they looked out for me for the rest of the day. That was a step beyond what they had to do. Lily Thomas intentionally writing letters to her classmates to encourage them even as she is also graduating. Sebastian Stubblefield, who after getting injured during his senior season, didn't get bitter, but rather invested in the next kicker by basically acting as his coach. Maggie Bevins in her dream of a senior girls' Bible study and her pursuit of each of us as she loved us for where we were. Jonah Dickerson, who seeks to not only know the names of every person sitting on this stage, but also to know more about their lives, going above and beyond to seek those who might otherwise be alone. Our yearbook this year claimed that we define us. I believe that we are a class of passion. which gives us endless opportunities in the future. So let's use it well and for the glory of God. A phrase that has been central in the life of my family is this: all you can control is your effort and your attitude. This means that no matter what life throws at you, we are responsible for how we react, both in action and in spirit. That doesn't mean we have to get it right all the time. It simply means we have to give our best in every situation. And every day, your best looks a little bit different because your best is not perfection. God doesn't call us to perfection because he knows that we would epically fail every day. Instead, he calls us to sanctification, which is the process of becoming more like him every day. That means that he loves us exactly where we are in this moment, not where we will be, where we should be, or even where we wish we were, but where we are right now. I believe in a God that is passionate about each one of us, and he has brought us all here together. And I, for one, am glad I chose to join this class of Lions back when I was a freshman. It has been an honor to see your heart and energy for life, and y'all have forever impacted mine. My time at CPA truly has shown me the value of the unseen heroes, those who simply serve and love well without recognition. They are the pictures of Christ's love that everyone can see and identify, from the toddlers all the way into our grandparents. Those are the people I believe are living their lives as if they are being changed by God, as if every day is a chance to show his love and mercy to the world around them. And that is how we change the world. We change it one smile, sticky note, or act of kindness at a time. In Romans 12, 1 and 2, it says, "Therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God." And that is my prayer for us, that we would use our endless energy and passion as a living sacrifice. And through continual sanctification, we would become separate from this world, that we would become redefined and transformed so that we would be able to understand the will of God. Class of 2019, if nothing else, remember the power you wield when you do not allow the world to define you. Because if you know that you always do your best, then no one can ask any more of you, and you always have something to be proud of. So let us choose to give our all, to invest our passion, and live out the lives of compassion that we are clearly capable of and called to, so that we can continue to be those heroes across the world.
Hello, my name is Reed Stout, and this year I had the honor of serving the senior class as class president. One aspect of my job this year was to help decide on and present the senior gift for the class of 2019. However, this idea was pretty easy for me. As the owner of the same water bottle for my entire four-year high school career, I've become well acquainted with the first floor as I journey far from my route to my next class and fill it up. So I feel like it's necessary to put a water fountain on like a second or third floor in a more convenient place so that everyone can stay hydrated. So, you know, we're putting another one of those water fountains on the second or third floor. thank you. You good?
Lights will move away. And they're going to better places. And our friends will be gone away.
Job. And now for our senior awards. Each year we award three seniors, and these awards are the three of the highest honors a CPA student can receive. They are voted annually by peers and the upper school faculty. The first award we give is the Servant Leadership Award to the student who has consistently displayed Christ's heart for others as evidenced by their service, willingly putting the needs of others ahead of their own conveniences. Second is our distinguished senior, a student who has stewarded their unique gifting and leveraged it on behalf of others. And finally, the Sloy Dale Glory Award, given to the student who fully embodies the school's culture and ethos as evidenced by living out its motto, Soli Deo Gloria. I would like to welcome our associate head of school for the upper school, Catherine Kane, to present our first award.
Good afternoon. If any of you are like me and you're asked to write a speech about a topic, the first place you go to is good old Webster for a great introduction. However, I'm not going to do that today because, to be honest, the person that I'm going to tell you about supersedes the actual definitions of the two words that they fulfill in this award, servant leadership. Think about it, two words that don't always go together. A servant is one who should be seen and not heard. They should work tirelessly and help anyone in need without putting themselves in the spotlight. But now think about a leader. Leaders often have large personalities and pretty loud voices. They have strong opinions and the means to have those opinions be heard. Putting both those terms, servant and leader, in the same phrase is a bit oxymoronic, kind of like jumbo shrimp, pretty ugly, or clear as mud. When faced with such cognitive dissonance, we must turn to God for the clarity. He tells us to wash each other's feet. He tells us that the last will be first. He tells us to love, not in words or speech, but in actions and in truth. These are Jesus' visions of leadership and servanthood. To be a servant leader means, in many ways, to combine the world's expectations of leaders and servants, as difficult as that may be. This year's recipient of the Servant Leadership Award has done just that in their years here at CPA. This student has led with humility, and I mean genuine humility. Even when accomplishing a goal, this student is quick to turn it to a group win. Not outwardly proud or boastful, this student at their core is absent of self. This student has led with wisdom and poise, approaching life and decisions with meaningful discernment, seeking the Lord in every decision. This student has led with kindness, encouragement, and cheerfulness, qualities that bear much fruit and is evidence of the Holy Spirit's presence in their life. This student has never sought the limelight. As a matter of fact, this very speech is staying anonymous for as long as possible because I know this person would feel super awkward knowing that we're talking about them. Oh, actually, once I tell you who it is, you'll understand that they probably would stand up here with a very big grin and say thank you at least 15 times. Do you have any idea yet? Let me see if this might help you. Throughout their time here at CPA, they have served as a member of the National Honor Society. They have been a teammate on both the cross-country and swim teams. They have led our school to yet another winning year in journalism for Yearbook. They have taken time to tutor refugee teens at Legacy Mission Village and inner-city children at Preston Taylor Ministries. They have organized, led, and volunteered during special Saturdays for CPC's special needs ministry. And they also have served as a delegate in Girls State. Most importantly, this young woman has led selflessly and with integrity, all for the glory of God. Will Carl and Gigi Sanders please stand while Elena Joy Sanders comes forward and accepts the Servant Leadership Award.
The next award is the Distinguished Senior Award, which is chosen by the faculty and presented to a senior who has distinguished him or herself in certain areas of school life at CPA, not just in the quantity of activities, but in the quality of the work. To be distinguished means to be prominent and worthy of respect through one's behavior or achievements. Simply put, it means to be set apart, celebrated, or influential in a particular area of excellence. For our purpose, this award goes to an individual who has distinguished him or herself over the past 4 years, but has done so in a manner that seeks to use his or her gifts in the service of advancing God's kingdom. The faculty chose this year's honoree based on the fact that this individual has excelled in multiple facets of the CPA community, from athletics to academics to leadership. Here are some of the comments teachers have shared this year. This student set an example for younger teammates with practice effort. It starts with the way that this student naturally serves others and operates from a position of humility. This person loves others, loves the gift of sport, and understands what sports should be used for. Loves the pursuit of excellence, but namely, loves what it means to be in relationship with others and what it means to pursue something bigger than themselves. This student is kind, attentive, and empathetic, cares about the needs of people, and desires to put others first. This student has a solid faith, has a drive to be the best, and demonstrates a pursuit of excellence that few students at this age attempt. My own recollections turn to the end of sophomore year when Coach Elson and I challenged this student to not wait until senior year to lead both in the hallways and on the ball fields. And this student rose to the challenge. He was All-State in football this year, All-State in basketball, head of house, had over a 4.0 GPA, winner of the Hancock Nipper Sportsmanship Award winner, and the Heart of a Lion Award winner. But perhaps the most endearing example of how this young man leads and loves others well is seen in how much he loves his younger sister, Sarah. So at this time, will Scott and Wendy McCormick please stand while I formally present this year's Distinguished Service Award to Mr. Bryce McCormick.
The Sole Deo Gloria Award, the highest honor bestowed upon a student, is given annually to the senior whose tenure best exemplifies the mission of Christ Presbyterian Academy, which is to see students come to know God, to evaluate all knowledge in life by his truth, to live transformed for his glory. The evaluation of knowledge is the highest level of learning in the educational process, and it is through the lens and filter of God's truth that we can accurately see and understand our world as it really is, providing a truly Christian worldview. However, seeing and thinking is not enough. Many of us have witnessed sights, learned new concepts, ideologies, and have experienced events that momentarily alter our equilibrium and provide a sharper, clearer image of life. But as normalcy returns and time passes, we go back to our routines and we lose focus. We lose our initiative. We lose our inspiration. Because to see and think is one thing, but to act, that is another matter entirely. For action takes courage. It takes sacrifice. It takes selflessness. It takes obedience. And to be obedient, one must first be humble. Thus, the second half of our mission, to live transformed. You see, this is hard because a person's character, how one lives, is determined by one's motives. And motive is always a matter of the heart, and all transformation begins in the heart. But I'm going to tell you, this student's heart is good. Self-aware, emotionally mature, globally minded, and self-assured without the slightest trace of arrogance. A poise and confidence allows this year's recipient to love and engage people freely without the restraint of apprehension or insecurity, but full of humility. And she doesn't even know it. She comes to life when she is with those who live on the margin, on the outside of, on the, she comes to life when she is with those who live on the margins of culture and society. Many students understand the importance of service hours, especially when applying to colleges. Thus, in a context like this, sometimes service becomes a self-promoting end. Not this young woman. She engages in an effort to build relationships and not only help others, but to learn from the very people she's helping. She recognizes the importance of widening her perspective and craves exposure to people who are different because she knows that learning to treat all people with dignity and all people with respect builds trust more effectively than loud proclamations of intelligence or success. She has a 100-watt smile. A smile strengthened because it knows disappointment. One teacher wrote me and said, I have seen this student deal with disappointment and turn around and be even better for it. She never begrudges her friends anything, but instead loves to celebrate other people, even when she didn't get the acceptance she wanted. You see, this smile knows a deeper truth. The truth of a Savior that says, you are mine, a daughter of the King. And while I could go on and on with vignettes as illustrations to validate her as a worthy recipient of our highest award, I will instead close with this. A 15-year teaching veteran of CPA writes, because of this student, I find myself smiling more, loving more, and trying to be more intentional with kindness when I approach all people. I want to be more like Lily Thomas. Would Mr. and Mrs. David and Connie Thomas please stand and be recognized as I present this year's award to Lily Thomas.
At this time, we will award the diplomas for the class of 2019. This year, we have a wonderfully large class, so please hold your applause until all 107 seniors have graduated. After I say each name, you will hear a verse read for each student. These verses were chosen for the students by their upper school advisor and will be read by that person as well. Abigail Timberlake Andrews.
Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. Isaiah 40, 28.
Austin Peyton Arnold.
Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. 1 Corinthians 1:26a, 30.
Robert Baker Avenger.
He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Isaiah 2, 4, and 5.
Maggie Taylor Bevins.
Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. Psalm 86, 11.
Catherine Dent Bostick.
So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10.
Morgan Isabel Brownlee.
This is what the Lord says. Stand at the crossroads and look. Ask for the ancient paths. Ask where the good way is and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls. Jeremiah 6, 16.
Elizabeth Ann Buell.
I guide you in the way of wisdom and lead you along straight paths. When you walk, your steps will not be hampered. When you run, you will not stumble. Hold on to instruction. Do not let it go. Guard it well, for it is your life. Proverbs 4, 11 through 13.
Grant Scott Buell.
Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Joshua 1:9.
Taylor Ann Burnett.
Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. My soul clings to you. Your right hand upholds me. Psalm 63, 7 and 8.
This is CPA's very first second generation graduate, Macy Elizabeth Camp.
But blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. Jeremiah 17, 7 through 8.
Abigail Campbell Clay.
Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Matthew 5, 7 through 8.
Gavin Brewer Clements.
Find rest, O my soul, in God alone. My hope comes from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. Psalm 62, 5 and 6.
Charles Adams Collier.
A man of many companions may come to ruin, but there's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. Proverbs 18, 24.
Finley Dean Cooper.
The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Psalm 121, 7 through 8.
Alexander James Cothran.
For I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways, and to keep his commands, decrees, and laws. Then you will live and increase, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to possess. Deuteronomy 30, 16.
John Thomas Crunk III.
My son, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Above all else, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Proverbs 4, 20 and 23.
Brianna Sue Davis.
Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. Isaiah 54, 10.
Ethan Todd Davis.
But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Acts 1:8.
Drake Marlowe Dawson.
Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Psalm 73, 25 and 26.
Clayton Bradford Dean.
Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in his ways. You will eat the fruits of your labor. Blessings and prosperity will be yours. Psalms 128, 1 and 2.
Jonah Brian Dickerson.
But seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Matthew 6, 33.
Anna Grace Dixon.
Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your heart on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. Colossians 3, 1 through 3.
Ryan Benjamin Elledge.
Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart. Psalms 119, 1 through 2.
Daniel Brewer Irvin.
We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ.
2 Corinthians 10:5.
Henry Clifford Fenton.
I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Psalms 121, 1 through 2.
Luke Owen Filson.
And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Ephesians 3, 17b through 19.
Caitlin Robinson Fisher.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Psalm 37, 3 and 4.
Abigail Ruth Francis.
Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Hebrews 11, 1.
Tanner Abraham Freeman.
As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. The one who guards a fig tree will eat its fruit, and whoever protects their master will be honored. As water reflects the face, so one's life reflects the heart. Proverbs 27, 17 through 19.
Leslie Nicole Fry.
Let the morning bring me word of your unfailing love, for I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I lift up my soul. Psalm 143, 8.
Philip Michael Fuller.
He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Micah 6, 8.
Grace Ann Gilbert.
You will be a crown of splendor in the Lord's hand, a royal diadem in the hand of your God. Isaiah 62, 3.
Anna Catherine Graham.
Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and of man. Proverbs 3, 3 and 4.
John Barrett Gregory.
Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Colossians 4, 2, and 6.
Madeline Elizabeth Hall.
I have filled her with the Spirit of God, with wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills to make artistic designs for work in gold, silver, and bronze. Exodus 31, 3 through 4.
Hallie Cecile Hazenbank.
The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Zephaniah 3, 17.
Gracie Ann Hawley.
And we pray this in order that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. Colossians 1, 10 and 11.
Noah Scott Henderson.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Psalms 27, 1 through 2.
Nicholas Peter Henson.
Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Colossians 3, 23 through 24.
William Ellis Horn.
For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but a spirit of power, of love, and of self-discipline. 2 Timothy 1, 7.
Carson James Houck.
And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. 2 Corinthians 9:8.
Sarah Ann Jacobs.
The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Deuteronomy 33:27.
Grace Sumner Jernigan.
Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. James 1, 2 through 4.
John Tatum Johnson III.
The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Exodus 33:14.
Nathan Paul Johnson.
Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good so that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Hebrews 13:20-21.
Bailey Morgan Jones.
My purpose is that you may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so that you may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that you may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Colossians 2:2-3.
Seth Allen Kane Jones.
For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Ephesians 2:10.
Eliza Lily Crowdell.
Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4:6-7.
Samuel Scott Lawrence.
We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. 1 Corinthians 2:6-7.
Megan McLeod Lewis.
For who is God besides the Lord? And who is the rock except our God? It is God who arms me with strength and keeps my way secure. 2 Samuel 22:32-34.
Sarah Elizabeth Long.
I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. Psalms 27:13-14.
Andrew McNeil Madden.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his holy people, for those who fear him lack nothing. Psalm 37:8-9.
Emma Louise Maddox.
Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Lamentations 3:22-23.
Macy Claire Maggard.
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Romans 15:13.
Bryson Scott McCormick.
The Lord will march out like a champion, like a warrior. He will stir up his zeal. With a shout, he will raise the battle cry and will triumph over his enemies. Isaiah 42:13.
Lorelei Estelle McDaniel.
I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. Psalm 89:1.
Caroline Isabel McDougall.
I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have being. May my meditation be pleasing to him. As for me, I shall be glad in the Lord. Psalm 104:33-34.
Isabella Treve Maisted.
Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people. Galatians 6, 9 through 10a.
Matthew Thomas Miller.
Praise be to the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war, my fingers for battle. He is my loving God and my fortress, my stronghold and my deliverer, my shield in whom I take refuge, who subdues people under me. Psalm 144, 1 and 2.
Anna Kate Milligan.
The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Exodus 14, 14.
Francesca Maria Moore.
The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to tread on the heights. Habakkuk 3:19.
Joseph Keegan Moore.
Then he said, the God of our fathers has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard. Acts 22:14-15.
Sydney Jean Moore.
I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength. Ephesians 1, 18 through 19.
Tanner Nicholas Morgan.
Call to me, and I will answer you and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. Jeremiah 33, 3.
Paul Brown Myers.
For the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He holds success in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones. Proverbs 2, 6 and 8.
Brett Allen Neighbors.
Let the beloved of the Lord rest secure in him, for he shields him all day long. And the one the Lord loves rests between his shoulders. Deuteronomy 33, 12.
Travis Donald Odom.
And you, my son, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches every heart and understands every motive behind the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found by you. 1 Chronicles 28, 9.
Celeste Angelina Pascarella.
Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will do this. He will make your righteousness shine like the dawn. Psalm 37, 5 and 6.
Fletcher Calvin Patterson.
Have faith in God, Jesus answered. Truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Mark 11, 22 through 23.
James McMahon Patterson III.
Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Romans 12, 11 and 12.
Samuel Kane Patterson.
A man of valor, a warrior, prudent in speech, and a man of good presence, and the Lord is with him. 1 Samuel 16, 18b.
Evan Armstrong Perrone.
Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. Isaiah 30, 21.
Rachel Christine Peary.
Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Psalm 91, 1 through 2.
Clay Dalton Posey.
But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. 1 John 1, 7.
Knox hit Preston.
Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all of your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. 1 Peter 5, 6, and 7.
Samuel MacArthur Rajbundant.
And those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. Isaiah 35, 10.
John Spalding Revis.
Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. James 1, 12.
John Michael Ritchie.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Numbers 6, 24 through 26.
Hannah Grace Roberts.
She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue. Proverbs 31, 25 and 26.
Harrison William Rohde.
But you, man of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. 1 Timothy 6, 11 and 12.
Jeffrey Preston Roten II.
I am the vine. You are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. John 15 and 5.
Abigail Jane Rudder.
And my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Philippians 4, 19.
Elena Joy Sanders.
I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness. Isaiah 61, 10.
Joe Tristan Payne Scaife.
He will be the sure foundation for your times, a rich store of salvation and wisdom and knowledge. The fear of the Lord is the key to this treasure. Isaiah 33, 6.
Seth Brennan Sheridan.
Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight, so that it may go well with you, and you may go in and take over the good land that the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Deuteronomy 6, 18.
Grant Hogan Slover.
Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." Isaiah 58, 8 through 9.
Margaret Ann Spodnick.
Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Romans 12, 2.
Ethan Alexander Stewart.
If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow all his commands, I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 2.
Jacob Daniel Stopcotti.
But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. Isaiah 43, 1.
Garrett Malone Stout.
In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Psalm 33, 21 and 22.
John McNeil Stout.
The blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow to it. Proverbs 10:22.
Richard Ellis Stout.
In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Matthew 5:16.
Sebastian Kyle Stubblefield.
Therefore, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. 2 Corinthians 3:12-17.
Briley McKenzie Thomas.
The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. My heart leaps for joy, and I will give thanks to him in song. Psalm 28:7.
Lillian Mabry Thomas.
In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. Titus 2:7-8.
Molly Ann Margaret Thorne.
He must become greater, I must become less. John 3:30.
Samuel Payne Chapnell.
But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. Psalm 13:5-6.
Harrison Remy Ware.
Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Psalm 103.
Catherine Elizabeth Weeks.
And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ. Philippians 1:9-10.
Samuel Keck West.
The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. Psalm 29:11.
Sarah Park Westmoreland.
And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All my fellow townsmen know that you are a woman of noble character. Ruth 3:11.
Foster Lee Watton.
Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. She will set a garland of grace on your head and present you with a crown of splendor. Proverbs 4:6-9.
Sanders Whittington Whiteside.
May he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. Psalm 20:4.
Catherine Grace Wright.
You keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. Isaiah 26:3.
Joshua Kearney Wright.
The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Psalm 18:2.
Avery Tristan Zapp.
You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Isaiah 55:12.
Congratulations to the class of 2019.
Let it out. There you go. I did tell them the other day they should be clapping for you because they didn't pay for it. You did.
It's true. In May of 1992, prior to our first graduation, Mr. Richard Anderson, our first head of school, was asked, "How will we know if this school has been successful?" So for 13 years, I've sat on the stage and I've pondered how I would answer this very same question. And now, as the privilege of giving you all the final blessing has been given to me in his absence, I know how I would have answered this first question. I would have responded, "Sir, I believe that's the wrong question." A school that pursues the unique design of each student, disciples them to discover their specific gifts and collective purpose as a foretaste of the coming kingdom. No, a school like that can't evaluate based on something as weak as success. No, success will tempt us to take our eyes off our own paper, to look to our left, to look to our right, and maybe even start to compare ourselves to someone else's standard of success. I don't care much about being a successful school, but I'll lay down my life as will this faculty for us to be a faithful school. A school that lives out its mission every single day. A school that doesn't find success when, but joy in seeing you, the class of 2019, walking with Jesus and growing in your convictions of his truth. For blessing and benediction, I will read over you the same thing that has been read over all 1,800 graduates since 1992. And this verse gets read every year, not because it affirms us as a faithful school, but because it points us to a faithful God. Now receive your benediction. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well. It gave me great joy when some believers came and testified about your faithfulness to the truth, telling how you continue to walk in it. For I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Amen.
Please stand and join us in singing the alma mater.
Be seated. Seniors, join your classmates. And this is the time you're going to want to take pictures, so I'll give you a little advance notice. Going.
Okay. And now, with the authority given to me by the Board of Trustees and Christ Presbyterian Church as the head of school for Christ Presbyterian Academy, I officially present to you the graduates of the class of 2019. Toss them up. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. I would like to invite you all to a reception with our graduates in the breezeway. Thank you.
Scott.